presence tonight, Father. Lord, we come once more to feast at your table, Lord, to be surrounded by your glory, your presence, Father. We pray that you come in a special way tonight. Lord, may you bless your people tonight, Father, gather together for Bible study tonight, Lord, and Lord, to study your scripture, Father, to your word, Lord. And we pray, Lord, Father, to open up your word to us. Bless us as this time, Lord, Father, as we get aside, Lord, away from the world and the things thereof, Lord, and just to hear from you for a few moments. Father, we pray you take charge, Lord. Bless each one that's gathered here tonight. Lord, may you speak to them, Lord, in a special way. And as we enter into your presence, may you bless each one, Lord, in a special way. In Jesus' name we pray and ask it. Amen. And amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Let's just give him praise tonight. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We love to be in his presence. Amen. Praise God. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. Amen. I worship you, Almighty God. There is none like you. Of peace, that is what I long to do. I give you praise, for you are my righteousness. I worship you, Almighty. Tonight, hallelujah, glory to God, amen, glory to God, not like you in all the earth, Father. Oh, we give you praise, Almighty God, amen, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus, amen, amen. Searched all over, couldn't find nobody, searched high and low, still couldn't find nobody. Nobody greater, nobody greater, nobody greater than you. Then searched all over, couldn't find nobody. still couldn't find nobody, nobody greater, nobody greater, nobody greater than you. Oh, I searched all over, couldn't find nobody. I searched high and low, still couldn't find nobody. Nobody greater, oh, nobody greater, nobody greater than you. Oh, oh, nobody greater, oh, nobody greater, nobody greater than you. Give him a shout of praise tonight, hallelujah. Oh, oh, I searched all over, oh, couldn't find nobody. Oh, searched high and low, still couldn't find nobody. Nobody greater, oh, well, nobody greater, nobody greater than you. Oh, well, nobody greater, oh, nobody greater, nobody greater than you. To the enemy's camp, and I took back what he stole from me. Took back what he stole from me. Mm-hmm. I took back what he stole from me. I went to the enemy's camp, and I took back what he stole from me. And now he's under my feet. He's under my feet. He's under my feet. He's under my feet. Oh, he's under my feet. He's under my feet. Satan is under my feet. Oh, run to the enemy's camp. And I took back what he stole from me. I took back what he stole from me. Oh, took back what he stole from me. I went to the enemy's camp. And I took back what he stole from me. And now he's under my feet. He's under my feet. He's under my feet. He's under my feet. Oh, he's under my feet. He's under my feet. Oh, Satan is under my feet. Well, now, oh, and I'm taking back everything that the devil stole from me. I'm taking back. I'm taking back everything that the devil stole from me. I'm taking back my song, my dance, my joy, and my peace. I'm taking it back. I'm taking back everything that the devil stole from me. Oh, one day old David came home from a city called Ziklag. And while he was gone, the enemy came and stole everything he had. But David encouraged himself in the Lord. He made up in his own mind. Oh, and I'm on my way down to hell's gates, and I'm taking what's rightfully mine. So come on, I'm taking back everything that the devil stole from me. I'm taking back, oh yeah, I'm taking back, oh, everything that the devil stole from me. I'm taking back my song, my dance, my joy, and my peace. I'm taking it back. I'm taking back everything that the devil stole. One more time. I'm taking back. I'm taking back everything that the devil stole from me. I'm taking back. I'm taking back everything that the devil stole from me. I'm taking back my song, my dance, my joy, and my peace. I'm taking it back. I'm taking back everything that the devil stole from me. Oh, give him a shout of praise tonight. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Glory to God. Glory to God. Amen. Amen. Blessed be the holy name of the Lord. Amen. Amen. I bless your name, I bless your name. I give you honor. I give you praise. You are the light, the truth, the way. I bless your name. I bless your name. I give you all, I give you praise. You are the light, the truth, the way. I bless your name, I bless your name.
Give him praise tonight.
I bless your name.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Give him praise tonight.
Bow our heads for a word of prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you tonight, Lord, that we could be, Lord, in your divine presence, Lord, united, Lord, by what you have done for us, Lord, for your love for us, Lord. Lord, there's not much we could have ever done to deserve this, but Lord, you could look through, Lord, time, Lord, and see us, Lord, at this point, Lord, and you were able to pick us up by the revealed word, Lord. You said the message would fall into the hands of the predestinated. Lord, we were not hunting for it. You were hunting for us, Lord. So, Lord, we thank you for your grace, the light that has shone in our direction, Lord, that could lead us to you, Father. Lord, we thank you for life, for health, for strength. We thank you, Lord, that we can make it to this meeting tonight, Lord, despite our struggles, despite our battles, despite, Lord, the different situations we have to deal with. Lord, we are here and we are so grateful. We are so thankful. We, Lord, don't have enough words to express how we feel, Lord. We thank you for, Lord, this body of believers, Lord, who have gathered, Lord, so faithfully. Lord, since this pandemic has led to, Lord, this new way of doing things, this new normal, Lord, as the media would coin that phrase, Lord, and we understand that through all of these situations, you have your way of working yourself out, Lord, to make yourself known to us in an even real way and to help us to come to a deeper understanding of who you are, who we are, and what we are fighting against. Lord, we truly believe that there's not much time left and we want to do all that we can do, Lord, so that we'll be ready, Father. It's a painful thought, Lord, to come some of the way Lord, and not go all the way. It's a very difficult thought, Lord, to have been, Lord, following this message for all these years and coming down to the closing pages, the closing seconds as time blends into eternity to miss it. So we want to be careful, Lord, through our study and our prayer and our meditation and our consecration and our dedication, Lord, to look inward as it were, Lord, and to find that balance. Lord, it's so easy to be fanatical. It is so easy to get caught up in so many different things that are not important, Lord. We want to come tonight to focus on what is important. We want to make the main thing as it were. So help us, Lord. If there's someone here tonight, Lord, who is struggling in their walk with you, Father, Lord, may they, Lord, be reminded of your goodness, of your plan, of your purpose, Lord, of your objectives and why you're doing all that you're doing. If there's someone who doesn't know you, may they come to know you by revelation and by experience. If there's someone, Lord, that needs healing, Lord, Lord, even as this word goes forth, because the scripture and the written word and the revealed word, Lord, there's power in the word. Lord, there's power. And Lord, you said even rapture in faith is laying in this message. So may the transforming power of God, Lord, Lord, through this medium, through this meeting, Lord, Lord, may you meet each one at the point of their needs. If there's a visitor in our gates tonight, Lord, may you touch them. Lord, may you reveal yourself to them. Lord, we are not here tonight, Lord, to focus on man or to focus on, Lord, an agenda, but Lord, we are here for, Lord, for growth, for edification, for change, for progress, for development, Lord. Lord, you want to see us progress. You want to see us grow. You said, add to your faith virtue and to virtue knowledge, and Lord, add all the way. So we come tonight to add something to our walk, to remind ourselves, to encourage one another. So Lord, may you speak to us tonight. Take me out of the way, Lord, and minister to us in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen and amen. Well, it's certainly a great privilege tonight to be gathered in this way one more time. I am not sure if we will ever get fully accustomed to this, and maybe we have already gotten accustomed to it, but I certainly don't take these meetings for granted and this great opportunity for granted. And because when we gather together like this, as simple as it may appear, we are speaking to the purchased of the blood of Jesus Christ. And that makes you and I the most valuable elements, you know, in this realm, in this dimension, that God would leave his abode, as it were, and take on a different form to ensure that we can make it, to ensure that there's a way of escape for us, to escape, you know, what is happening in this world today, and to understand that there's a bigger plan, there's a bigger purpose, you know. And I was sharing with Brother Ovid on a call today. I say it's a rough time. So it's a rough time, you know. And, you know, Brother Branham said that you can't enjoy the mountain tops unless you've been in a valley. You know, if you're always on top of the mountain, you wouldn't, after a while, it'd get boring, you know. If you're on the mountain top all the time, the mountain might get boring. But when you spend a little time in the valley and you come back up to the mountain top, boy, that mountain top looks totally different. You know, you might have been there before, but because you are coming from a place in the valley, that mountain has a whole different meaning to you because of the journey. And life is a journey. And as you go through scripture and you see it, you know, sometimes it makes you almost, you start to feel less sorry for yourself. You know, I don't know what your journey is like. I could only speak, you know, from my experience. You know, I haven't had your experience or your journey, but I am sure there are times when you feel you're on top of your game, and there are times you feel like you out the game. You know, and there are times you feel like giving up, throwing in the towel, you wrap up the towel, you burn the towel, you don't want nothing to do with the war. You want to know if God really called you, if God really chose you, if this thing is for you, you know. And so many things in life we go through that challenges, it almost creates what we call an existential crisis. You wonder if you're cut out for this thing, you know. But look, here you are, here I am, you know, we are in this room. And the devil taught you to miss it. The devil taught you to give up. But here you are pressing on with all that you know. You might be tired. You might have had a rough day. You might have questions in your life about different things. But yet you report in for duty, looking for God to do something for you, looking for God to answer a question, looking for God to give you direction, looking for him to give comfort, because he promised to never leave us. He promised to never forsake us. He promised to be our comforter. You know, even the Spirit of truth, you know, whom the world cannot receive, but because we receive him, you know, we have a direction, we have a hope, we have an anchor, you know. So I really want to thank God for how he is unveiling himself to us, and to see in our little small island here in Trinidad how, you know, the world has gone through so many things, and so many things are happening in so many different ways. We have spent a lot of time going through these things, but it is interesting to see how, you know, by the grace of God, this country once again, how God has blessed us, and, you know, other countries have really had a very difficult time during this pandemic, and, you know, we feel for them. We certainly have our prayers out, and we certainly would, you know, be very concerned with what's happening. It's so many fellowships and believers and situations and challenges, and we can see through all of these things is the grace of God to us and to every situation, because God will never give us more than we can bear. So we thank God, you know, that we could still, you know, even with the guidelines and so forth, be able to gather and do different things, knowing that there'll come a day when we cannot gather and cannot do certain things. So we don't take this for granted, and we certainly don't take your attendance tonight for granted as well. You know, it's a choice. It's a choice that we make. You know, life is about choices and decisions. And I love listening to audiobooks. I've shared this before, and I know in these Bible sessions and these conversations, you know, we can kind of share a little bit more. And I find myself, you know, trying to redeem the time, as it were. You know, there's so many ways to use your time, and the devil has created so many, you know, distractions and ways to pull your attention. And if you don't have a plan for your spiritual development, you know, via reading the word, via your prayer life, via, you know, attending services, listening to the tapes, you know, spending time in the prophet's message, you know, you know, you'll find yourself drifting, because there's more than enough information out there. The Bible talks about knowledge will increase. If there's ever an age where knowledge has increased, there's enough content that you can't even fit it, you know, into one day's sitting with what is happening every single day. So it is a choice. It is a choice that you're here tonight. It's a choice, you know, now that you're along this road, you know, as the prophet would have experienced through that French, you know, speaking in tongues, because thou hast chosen, you know, it's the harder way, it's the rougher way, you know, it is a, you know, it's not an easy decision to make. At any point in time, you know, you might be inclined to walk away, but you're still here. And because you chose that narrow way, a huge portion of heaven awaits you. So, and I was truly blessed Sunday service. God bless you, Brother Ovid. What a tremendous blessing. And I want to draw a specific mention as well to last week's Bible study. And, you know, how good the Lord used Brother Ovid in a tremendous way. And then also that presentation we had last Sunday from Voice of God with Brother Felix, and the sharing of what has happened, what is happening, and truly what is still to happen, and the great work and the great effort to bring this message out, you know, to all ends of the world. And it is really a great responsibility, and it's also a great blessing. And if it's one thing that I took from the presentation on Sunday, is that, you know, when he was sharing about, you know, the translations and how many of the books have been translated, and how privileged we are, you know, when he said that, you know, only 20% of the world speaks English, that we have, you know, firsthand access, as it were, you know, to the prophet's books and the prophet's tapes. And there are so many in other countries who, you know, are eagerly, are desperately waiting for a book to be translated. And it shows that, you know, so many of us may take it for granted, not realizing what we have, you know, how easily we could just log on or pull a book and listen to a tape. You know, and the question is begged to be asked, what are we doing, you know, with what we have? You know, what are we doing with what we have? Because to whom much is given, much is expected, you know, and it is a challenge to us all, you know, to do better, to do more, to push more. You know, it is easy, you know, and we live in a world where it's easy to be complacent. It's easy to just sit back and take things for granted. And this spirit of entitlement, we spoke about it before, you know, where people expect things to just come to them a certain way and expect things to work in a certain way without the effort, you know. And for English speakers, it is a somewhat of a rebuke to us that we could do a lot more with what we have been given. You know, people sit down in church and you know, they don't do their homework. And what is the homework? Meditate on the word day and night. You know, they leave it up to the minister to go and study and bring the word. But if you study and you are in prayer and you are in the spirit, as we know, the prophet said the minister could never bring the revival. You know, the revival comes from the people, you know. So the outcome of this Bible study, the outcome of the service on Wednesday night, the outcome of the prayer meeting, the outcome of Sunday service is actually directly correlated with your activity, with your effort, with your input determines the output, you know. And, you know, it is really true that as the brother said on Sunday, yes, you know, we are waiting on the Lord, but God is also waiting on us. He's waiting on his church to get into action. And he said, when she recognizes who she is, you know, then the rapture will go, you know. So I really pray throughout all that we are going through, we are getting to a deeper recognition, you know, of who we are, you know. And I want to share this last point before I get into the scripture, you know. And I was listening to an audiobook and it was speaking about how easy it is to look outward, you know, how so many of us blame so many different, I will call it things in brackets. We blame so many things for what is happening with us. You know, people blame the economy for what's happening with them. People blame their history for what's happening with them. People blame their neighborhood. People blame the school teacher and what the school teacher never did or didn't do. They blame what their parents had or didn't have. They blame what the pastor should have done or didn't do. They blame what the usher did and the usher didn't do. And they blame their children. They blame all kinds of stuff, you know. And the reality is, whenever you turn the blame to outward, and I'm not saying that there are not situations where things happen to you or, you know, but the reality is, you do not have any control over anybody else. And that's a foundational, you know, concept that we have to resonate with us. You know, many times, you know, we almost pray that, you know, Lord, change them and change them and change that and change that. And there's nothing wrong with bringing situations to God to intervene on and about, but few people really bring the prayer to Lord, change me, you know? And I really found, as I was looking more into the word, you know, there's a great power in being able to have God transform you. Because if God transform your life and your thinking and your approach and your understanding and give you the tools, like Solomon prayed for wisdom and the wisdom he got equipped him to deal with a myriad of situations, how different the quality of our lives are, you know? And to be encouraged by scripture that says, if any man lacks wisdom or any man wants wisdom, let him ask for it. And wisdom is not a degree. Wisdom is not O levels. Wisdom is not A levels. Wisdom is being able to put knowledge and understanding to good use. And God is freely giving wisdom to anybody who lacks it. You know, just think about that. If any man lack wisdom, doesn't have it, let him ask for it, you know. So we want wisdom of revelation. We want wisdom to understand the word. But beyond that, we also want wisdom to live. Because we're living in this world, but we're not of this world. So you don't want to be so spiritually wise that you don't know how to navigate your job and navigate your family and navigate these situations. Because the great test for us as Christians is not so much when we come and read and study. The test is when a test is the exam of when situations change in your environment and you have a choice to respond, you know. And I'm going to reach a point, hopefully by the grace of God, and if the Lord wills, where we will see one brother, how the testimony about him. And when I read it, it kind of really blew my mind. You know, it's a reminder to us of what God wants from us. So by the grace of God tonight, we could dive in. I don't intend to be too long. I know I say that at times and then I get excited and I still try to keep it contained. But by the grace of God, we want to be back in the book of Revelation. So this will be a study of the book of Revelation. This is Brother Clarence. I know I would have had like part ones and part A's and different things before, and I never get to the thing, but I am, you know, I am trying to be a little, you know, more structured. I spoke to Brother Stephen Oliveri and I tried to get some coaching and different things, you know. So by the grace of God, it's a study about revision 3 part B. So I'm continuing from the last session 2 weeks ago by the grace of God. And just by way of background, I just want to read to where we are at, you know, and then we kind of build from there and kind of continue along the road. So we would have started, as you know, at the beginning of our Bible study this year on the book of Revelation and introduced it with John and the Isle of Patmos and all of that whole experience with how he ended up there. They tried to boil him and different things. And we know that he was, you know, he's not the author, but he's the scribe, and it's Jesus speaking to him, to the different messengers, to the different churches. And we would have spent that time in Revelation 1, kind of laying a foundation in that first teaching. And then we would have built, and we would have reached that point where we were in Revelation 2. And I just want to quickly read from Revelation 2 until we reach where we left off the last time. So Revelation 2, verse 1, unto the angel of the church of Ephesus, we know is the first church age. We know Paul was a messenger to that age, right? These things said he that holdeth the 7 stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the 7 golden candlesticks. We would have touched on the 7 stars, who are the 7 messengers, men, angels, if you want to say that, to the 7 church ages. And it is Jesus Christ who is walking in the midst of the churches. And we thank God that he is the one walking through, making sure that his bride through each age is protected, is preserved, and he's given her that push, as it were, that inspiration, that unction to fight. And every age, thus far we have read, started like verse 2, I know thy works, and it goes on, and thy labor, and thy patience. What a testimony, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil. There's a testimony to us of love anything God loves and hate anything that God hates. And thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them liars. This was the attribute of that first age that was built right off from the day of Pentecost, that first powerful, mighty church, that Ephesians church, that we know there must be another Ephesians again. Verse 3, and has borne and has patience, and for my name's sake has labored and has not fainted. Powerful testimony to us, even to today, that has borne and has patience, and for his name's sake we are laboring. We are laboring tonight. We have not fainted. We have reported for duty. We are not giving up. We are not backsliding. We might have ups and downs, but through it all, it's a labor. That's what labor means. It's not easy, but it's effort, and we're not fainting, you know. For nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. And we have brought out how easy it is, you know, to fall from that place, that position, that commitment, that zeal, that enthusiasm, that passion. And we all go through these situations where things come and you're kind of out of the spirit, and it's an effort to get back in the spirit. And we would have talked about how Brother Brandon brought it out, that God never leaves us as we leave God, you know. And if you want to get back to him, you have to go right back to where we left him. And it's a constant reminder to us. And Brother Brandon would have shown us, you know, in that, remember from whence I would fall, and repent and do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly and remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. Can you hear me? I think my internet just dropped a bit. Yeah, okay. Verse 6, but this thou hast, you know, so this is what's going for you, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. So I would have drawn out in teaching this, that this is the very best of management being displayed here. There's nothing to compare how God would have given them this powerful salutation, you know, to let them know what he liked about them. Then he went on to address what they needed to fix. And then he would have come and say, okay, but this is also what is going for you, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Then it went on to verse 7, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. So is a deep cry that there are people who are hearing, but they're not acting. They're not recognizing. But to him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. And then we would have reached here in our last teaching, and unto the angel of the church of Smyrna, So this is, we would have introduced Irenaeus, who was a student of Polycarp. You remember that. And we brought it out how mighty Polycarp was. And we spent that time and how they tried to kill Polycarp and they put him on the burning stake. And he said, oh, tie my hands and all that stuff. He went through that. And yet still with all of his strength, you know, he was tending a little organization. And it was his student, as it were, Irenaeus, who would take up the mantle and be named as the messenger of that age of Smyrna, which was that bitter age. Thus saith, these things saith the first and the last, which was dead and is alive. So we know who that is, the Lord Jesus Christ. And I know thy works and tribulation and poverty, but thou art rich. And I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan. We would have spent, and that was the verse we have actually would have reached in our last teaching. And what we would have been seeing here between this first age and this second age was a gradual decline, as it were, with the strength of the Ephesians age and the beginning, as it were, of the deeds of the Nicolaitans. It was just deeds or behaviors or activities or actions that were beginning to creep in. But by the time you're in Smyrna, it's getting already a bit darker. It is getting a bit more treacherous. And what we see happening is that there are those who say they are Jews, but they are not. So deception is creeping in, and there are people coming in, perverting the way that the church is. And then we reach verse 10, fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. All right, so it's a powerful message when you meet that fear not. And Brother Branham many times say, that fear not is really a comfort, because it's as if God is seeing you going through some trouble or facing a challenge. So it's not just fear not, you know, in an abstract kind of way, but because of the context of the situation, he's saying, fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. You know, you might feel fear coming on, but don't fear. It might look treacherous, but don't fear. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison that he may be tried, and he shall have tribulation 10 days. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death. So I just want to touch quickly on these two verses, and then we're going to go into verse 12. And I would have read how the prophet would have said, you know, as we were tying up that point last meeting on those who call themselves Jews but are not. And we would have read where Brother Ram said, it doesn't matter if you call yourself a Christian. Anyone can do that. The point is whether or not you have the Spirit of God in you, for without that Spirit, you are reprobate. So we are making a strong point, and this is now I'm speaking to believers tonight, that it is not what you call yourself. Whether you call yourself a Christian or you call yourself a message believer or you're in the message, that has nothing to do with it. I've seen many people call themselves all kinds of things, but there's no life to back up what they're calling. And there's no spirit, and there's no effort, no push to really live this word. So he's saying that's the same thing that they had in that day, all right? So just to kind of bring some closure to this before I go on to the next. But Brother Branham said, when the church gets away from the word, it will believe anything. It is like Eve. When Cain was born, she said, I've gotten a man from the Lord. Now, do you realize she really meant that? She thought she had a man from the Lord. So Brother Branham is saying that she actually deceived herself. You see, once she had been deceived by taking the word of Satan instead of the word of God, she then thought that whatever she said was right. All right? So it is a reminder to us of how careful we have to be with the word. So I really want to head to the next church age, but I want to just tie this up here. Brother Branham said the poor Smyrnian age was dying. When it died, it never came back. No age ever comes back. No revival ever comes back. It can't have the life of God in it by natural generation. It takes a regeneration from above. In other words, it's not the efforts of man. No man could have restored what was broken. What had crept in, man could not undo. It could only take God's intervention to be able to reverse the effects. So man can't sit down and plan a revival. You can't sit down and negotiate a revival. It is not by who you invite for a meeting. It has to be Spirit-led, you see? And Brother Branham said this last age started with the fires of a Pentecostal revival, and they organized it right back. Instead of taking the word, they took their own ideas and did just what every age has done, substituted the manual for the word. Just you step outside that manual and see what happens, you are out. You see? And he's basically, by that manual, he's referring to the playbook or the way the message says it should be and how we should have a service and how we should say certain things and who should get credit for this and that and the other. And that's why we thank God so much that every church is sovereign and that there's no higher order or office in the local church and the local elder of that church. And we thank God that is what he loves. He loves to deal with his children. He loves to deal with his church on an individual basis. Yes, it's a bride, but he is more than able. Let me say this. God is more than able to speak the needs of this specific sovereign church that may be different in need to another sovereign church. So I don't need to know what somebody else is doing to see if what we're doing is right. Anybody with me tonight? Do we trust God that he is able to minister to this local church what he needs this local church to hear? Because if you don't have confidence in God, listen carefully to what I'm saying, not confidence in me or even confidence in Brother Ovid, you know, confidence in God's ability to bring food for this tabernacle, that this tabernacle needs to mature, to grow, to deal with the situations that we as a church have to deal with in our environment, in our country, in our situation, in our walk of life, just as he is as capable to deal with in another country, in another situation, in another dynamic. Is anybody with me tonight? So the whole everybody doing this and the bride move, is everybody connecting this way? The more you read this, you realize how that can't even stand up on a stick, on five sticks, on a foundation. You can't build it on that. That the church could only be built by the revelation of Jesus Christ and the Holy Ghost as the head leading the church to where he should go. You know, and that is where that whole Nicolaitan thing, Brother Branham said, was putting a wedge between man and God. But God wants you to deal with individuals tonight. I didn't call it in this room, but God called it in this room to hear about himself. We want to focus on what he wants us to hear. And you should be able to shoot me if I say anything wrong, because you're supposed to be like Paul say, follow me as I follow Christ. So those who followed Paul had to have the word so they could see always if what Paul's saying lining up with his word. And Paul would be so convinced of his teaching. He say, if an angel come from heaven and say anything else, or if I myself come after and say something different, then curse all of we. But this gospel is right. This scripture is true. So we want our faith, our revelation, our understanding to be solid. Because if it's solid on the word, then if anybody backslide, you could be the last man standing. Nobody could move you. The devil could blow, he could huff and he could puff. And you could stand firm, stand sure, stand strong. Because your foundation is not in a man, your umbilical cord, not in a group, or even local church history. Oh gosh, help me tonight. You have people who like their local church history, you know. This is where the church was, and this is where God carries us. All that is good and fine, you know. I am not fighting local church history, but I want to make sure my umbilical cord is tied to glory. Not to where the church was in this year, and the church was in this year, and the church was, because I see people sing that song, and they're nowhere wrong now. And where the church journeyed, and what building it was in, is not enough of a connection to take it to glory. But where you were before the foundation of the world, that connection could take you right back there. Anybody with me tonight? So we want the foundation of our faith, because when the tests come, and believe you me, all that we have gone through is small tests. Eh? Let me just break this news to us tonight. That as Brother Ovid would preach, we have yet to be led into the wilderness. Ay, 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 ay. Most of the trials that we have endured and we go through is by our own making, you know. You doing this, you doing that, you make a bad decision and you have to deal with the consequences. Some of us have had to deal with bigger consequences than others, but those are self-inflicted situations that God allow us to go through so that character can be formed in us. But there's still a test that God is specially designing for us that will require character to overcome and will form even greater character in us so we could overcome all the way to the rapture. And that's what we are contending for. That's what we are contesting for. That's what we are fighting for. And the church say amen. So I want to kind of wrap up. I'm still wrapping up. This is from the last time. And he said that this last age, we're dealing with Smyrna still, started with the fires. So it starts right now. But they organized it. So how it ended up is not how it started. and they tried to organize it, and they had a manual, who's supposed to lead songs, how long the song service is supposed to be, how it's supposed to be, and but the man says, step outside that manual and see what happens. You are out, brother. So if you sing too long or sing too short or sing and you write the song the right way and you play the right chord and you dress a certain way and do a certain thing, you're out. And they will persecute you and blame it on God. How they love their organization. No wonder they are second generation Pentecostals. And since God doesn't have grandchildren, they are just children of their fathers, known by their creeds and form of worship. They can talk about what used to be, but they can't produce it. Once they had the lightning, but after all that is left is the thunder. Now let them talk to you about the glories of their movement. They will say, yes, sir, I want you to know that this is the move that no man started. It came spontaneously. The Spirit fell all over the world. Yes, sir, we've got what they had at Pentecost. That this was not of men, but of God. But then Brother Branham has in block letters here. Then why didn't they keep it that way? If God started it, how come God couldn't finish it? How God couldn't keep it and finish it? You see, God didn't write a handbook of creeds and formulas and dogmas to start it. Then what right did they have to do that? So I'm just nailing that down there. And just to kind of bring this to a close, just for church history and for your own knowledge as well, when we read that scripture that you may be tried and you shall have tribulation for 10 days, but Abraham brought out that that was actually a prophecy, and that Diocletian, the cruelest of all emperors, launched a terror campaign against the saints of God. That except for the mercy of God in that Smyrnian age, would have wiped out all believers. It was the bloodiest in history, and it lasted for 10 days. All right, so just so you know that. So I will kind of leave the rest of that in the interest of time to get into where I want to get to tonight, because it's a lot, and I kind of just want to bring some points in this now. So let's go on, and believe in me, we'll come back to many of these things and bring some more light on it, but we want you to grow and continue to get strength in the Lord. So we're moving on to the third church age here, from verse 12, and to the angel of the church in Pergamos write, these things said he, which hath the sharp sword with two edges. So we know who we're talking about. You know that two-edged sword, wood. Anybody with me? I know I'm speaking to mature students tonight, all right? So I want to touch on this age of Pergamos, as in the other ages where we would have spoken about Paul and Irenaeus, and students would know that we're talking about Martin now in this age. But I want to bring on some stuff to lay a context, because the reality is sometimes we look through scripture and we look through, you know, the word, and it sometimes feel as if, you know, a lot of the characters we speak to in scripture are very different from us. You know, so I'm grateful that God in his wisdom allow us to see insight into different prophets in different ways. You know, so I would say David, for example, is one of the few that we can see him as a boy. We can see him as a young man. We can see him as an adult. We can see him as an old man on his bed, still planning what the legacy would be and how Solomon would take over and these things. And God gives us these kind of insight. So we have the life of the prophet who lived out before us, but also we have the life of Brother Branham would have spent a lot of time looking into the lives of these great messengers. So I want to just give a little background so you understand, one, your church history, and two, you also understand the foundation of what these things mean. So Pergamos, in the Amplified, it is referred to as Pergamum. And Brother Branham also said that is the ancient name. Pergamum was situated in Mysia, in a district watered by three rivers, by one of which it communicated to the sea. So three rivers and one flowed to the sea. It was described as the most illustrious city in Asia. It was a city of culture with a library second only to that in Alexandria. Yet it was a city of great sin, given over to licentious rites of the worship of Alculapius, whom they worship in the form, listen to this, in that day, in that age, they worshiped in the form of a living serpent, which was housed and fed in the temple. So I want you to picture this. In that day, in the temple, they actually had a serpent that they fed and they mined in the temple to worship. That was the conditions of the day. So when we talk about serpent and the serpent seed and the spirit of the serpent and the devil and all these things, look how in that day, and look how long ago that was, they were already into that, all right? In this beautiful city, Brother Branham said, of irrigated groves, public walks and parks, lived a small group of dedicated believers who were not fooled by the veneer of beauty and they abhorred the satanic worship that filled the place. So what we are seeing here now is from that first age of Ephesus to Smyrna to Pergamos, it is a decline that became a very steep, rapid decline in that age of Pergamos. In fact, Brother Branham, in describing this age, was calling this age, he said, this is the actual seat or the throne of Satan. This is the characteristic of that age, right? The Pergamian age lasted about 300 years, from 312 to 606 AD. Now, Brother Branham said that Martin was born in 315 in Hungary. However, his life work was in France, where he labored in and around Tours as a bishop. He died in 399. So we are speaking about the messenger of the age. So I want us to have a little understanding of it. Some of us would know this. Some of us would never spend that time looking at it. So we want to take a look at it. Martin was converted to Christ while he was following a career as a professional soldier. So normal living, you're a professional soldier. He's a career professional. It was while he was still engaged in this occupation that a most remarkable miracle occurred. It is recorded that a beggar lay sick in the streets of the town where Martin was posted. The winter cold was more than he could bear, for he was poorly clad. So this beggar is there with very little clothes. No one paid attention to his needs until Martin, young soldier Martin, came by. Seeing this poor man's plight, but not having an extra garment, he took off his outer cloak, cut it in two with his sword, and wrapped the cloth around the freezing man. He attended him the best he could, and he went on his way. So we see a man with a caring heart, nobody else paying any attention, and there's just something about this young man. That night, Brother Branham said, the Lord Jesus appeared unto him in a vision, and there he stood like a beggar, wrapped in the half of Martin's garment. So in Martin's action, his activity, it stirred something. So you see how your simplest of action and activity could actually stir something? He spoke to him and said, Martin, though he is only a catechumen, has clothed me with this garment. From that time on, Martin sought to serve the Lord with all of his heart. His life became a series of miracles manifesting the power of God. I want to go a little further. After having left the army, we're dealing with the messenger of the age. Huh? So we understand Paul. We have a lot about Paul. We got something about Irenaeus. Now we're looking at Martin a little bit, and I want us to see from his life and his role and how he lived, there has to be something in this that we could also reflect. We could also mirror, because there's something about him, because this is still one of the seven stars. Out of all the ages, seven stars, God carefully picked these seven stars to speak to the bride in their age. And these men all led up to what we have today, all right? After having left the army and having become a leader in the church, he took a very militant stand against idolatry. So I like how the prophet puts that, because it takes a military man to take a militant stand. So he is connecting words here, but I don't take it lightly, because words have meaning. So God picks a man from his experiences, from his journey, to use him a certain way. God could have used Peter a certain kind of way. He could have used John a certain kind of way. When he wanted to find somebody to write all the books in the New Testament, he found a scholar who was named Saul, who became Paul, who was an academic, who would have sat at the feet of Gamaliel. So God, when he picks somebody for a job, he is very careful in his selection. So when he wanted a writer, he picked Paul. When he wanted now a militant to deal with the pressures of this age and what is happening in this age, he took a man with a military background, so he can be militant and take a militant stand against idolatry. So I want to now connect that, and I want us to be conscious that there is no accident in God. Your journey, where you're born, what you went through, is always part of what is preparing you to deal with the now and to deal with what's ahead. So I don't want you to have the pity party of what you've been through and what you didn't have or what didn't work out. We have to always see that there's a hand of God, the hidden hand of God, that's bringing us a certain spot. So listen to the description here, Brother Branham goes on. This is Martin. He cut down the groves, broke up the images, and pulled down the altars. When confronted by the pagans for his deeds, he challenged them in much the same manner that Elijah did the prophets of Baal. He offered to be tied to a tree on his underside so that when it was cut down, it would crush him. Listen carefully. Unless God intervened and turned the tree around while it fell. You see the kind of faith and conviction these men had? Peter said, hang me upside down. They throw John in boiling oil. They throw Polycarp on the stake. When they pierce him, water come out. This is the journey that this message is going through, all right? The wily heathen tied him to a tree that was growing on the side of a hill, assured that the natural pull of gravity would cause the tree to fall as to crush him. Just as the tree began to fall, God swung it around and uphill, contrary to all natural laws. So they pick a spot that was high in a certain way that gravity would ensure that the tree fall. But God, contrary to all natural laws, swung it around and sent the tree back uphill. The fleeing heathen were crushed as the tree fell on several of them. Historians acknowledge that at least three occasions he raised the dead by faith in Jesus' name. In one instance, he prayed for a dead baby. Like Elisha, he stretched himself upon the babe and prayed. It came back to life and health. On another occasion, he was called to help deliver a brother who was being carried away to his death in a time of great persecution. By the time he arrived, the poor man was already dead. They had hanged him upon a tree. His body was lifeless and his eyes protruded from the sockets. But Martin took him down, and when he had prayed, the man was restored to life and to his rejoicing family. We ain't going into the age yet, eh? We're just talking about the messenger here, right? Martin never did fear the enemy, regardless of who it was. You see, I like that kind of thing. You see that kind of, that is real. I love that kind of thing. Martin never did fear the enemy, regardless of who it was. Thus, he went to personally face a wicked emperor who was responsible for the death of many spirit-filled Christians. The emperor would not grant an audience, so Martin went to see a friend of the emperor, one Damasus, a cruel bishop of Rome. You see how these brothers were not afraid to confront for what they believe? But the bishop, being a nominal Christian of the false vine, it takes a prophet to say that, eh? A nominal Christian of the false vine, would not intercede. Martin went back to the palace, but by now the gates had been locked and they would not allow him to enter. He laid down. Now, I don't know about you. If the gate locked, you might say, well, I'll go back home next time. Martin see the gate locked. He wanted to go and talk to the emperor about the persecution of the Christians. And he lay down on his face before the Lord and prayed that he be able to get into the palace. He heard a voice bidding him arise. When he did so, he saw the gates open of their own accord. You see, automatic gate. I love how God is operating. So this is our history. He walked into the court, but the arrogant ruler would not turn his head and speak to him. Martin again prayed. Suddenly, a fire came spontaneously from the seat of the throne, and the unhappy emperor vacated speedily. Surely the Lord humbles the proud and exalts the lowly. That's what the prophet is saying there. But Brother Branham is making a point. He says such was his ardor. Ardor is like passion, his zeal, his fervency. Do you have a passion about this gospel, about the truth? If you know this is the truth, how enthusiastic about you? How enthusiastic are you about this thing? Such was his ardor in serving the Lord that the devil was mightily aroused. In other words, he was on the radar. The alarm keep tripping in hell. When Martin was moving, the devil alarm keep triggering because this man was a disruptor. The enemies, listen to this one. I was reading this over and I say to my wife, well, this one's serious. The enemies of truth hired assassins to kill Martin. Process that for a minute. The enemies of truth hired assassins to kill Martin. They came by stealth to his home. And as they were about to kill him, he stood erect and bared his throat to the sword. As they leaped forward, the power of God suddenly hurled them back across the room. So overcome were they in that holy and fearful atmosphere that they crawled upon their hands and knees and begged forgiveness for the attempt upon his life. You see what happens when you stand for God and you're in line with his word and his will? Too often, when men are signally used of the Lord, they become lifted up with pride. But not so with Martin. He ever remained the humble servant of God. One night, I remember Brother Ovid preaching on this, one night as he was preparing himself to enter the pulpit, a beggar came to his study. He's about to go and preach. And a beggar came to his study and asked for some clothing. Martin referred the beggar to his head deacon. The haughty deacon commanded him to leave. Thereupon, the beggar went back to Martin. Martin arose and gave the beggar his own fine robe and bade the deacon bring him another robe of lesser quality. That night, as Martin preached the word, the flock of God saw a soft white glow of light around his person. Surely, Brother Branham said, this was a great man of God. A great man, a true messenger to that age. Never desirous of aught but to please God. He lived, and this is what I want to get to. He lived a most consecrated life. You see, these are the triggers for me. He lived a most consecrated life. Never could he be induced to preach until he had first prayed and was in such a spiritual frame as to know and deliver the full counsel of God by the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven. Often he would keep the people waiting while he prayed for full assurance. My God. Just to know about Martin and his mighty ministry might make one think that the persecution of the saints had abated. Not so. They were still being destroyed. So Brother Branham is saying, even though this was the quality of the messenger of that age, the Christians, they were still being destroyed by the devil through the instrumentality of the wicked. They were burned at the stake. They were nailed to logs face down, and wild dogs were turned loose upon them so that the dogs would tear away the flesh and bowels, leaving the victims to die in terrible torture. Babes were ripped from expectant mothers and thrown to the hogs. Women's breasts were cut away, and they were forced to stand erect while each heart throb poured the blood until they crumbled in death. And the tragedy was even greater to think about when one realizes that this was not solely the work of the heathen, but many times it was caused by so-called Christians who felt that they did God a favor in exterminating these loyal soldiers of the cross who stood for the word and obedience to the Holy Spirit. This is not words here. This is history. By signs and wonders, by the power of the Spirit, Martin was truly vindicated as a messenger to that age. But not only was he gifted by a great ministry, he himself was forever true to the word of God. He fought organization. He withstood sin in high places. He championed the truth in word and deed and lived out a full life. I love that. A full life of Christian victory. What do you want people to write about you and your life and your testimony and your walk? I love that. He championed the truth in word and deed and lived out a full life of Christian victory. Lord, help us to live out a full life of Christian victory. Lord, help us to champion the truth in word and deed. Not word only, but deed. Deed is action. Deed is doing. Listen to this. A biographer wrote of him on this wise. No one ever saw him angry or disturbed or grieving or laughing. This is a special kind of man. Eh? He was always one and the same and seemed something beyond mortal, wearing on his countenance a sort of celestial joy. Never was anything on his lips but Christ. Lord help us. Never was there anything on his lips but Christ. never anything in his heart but piety, peace, and pity. Often did he weep for the sins even of those, his detractors, who when he was quiet and absent, attacked him with viperous lips and poison tongues. Many hated him for virtues they themselves did not possess and could not imitate. I love that. Did not possess and could not imitate. Oh my. And alas, his bitterest assailants were bishops. Fellow brothers, you know the ministering brothers. Hallelujah. Glory. So just to give a bit of a snapshot on the age, on the messenger of the age. For some, it's a reminder. For some, may not have read this in some time. For some, never took time to focus on this. But I personally believe everything is important. Our history, our journey, our path. And the reality is, many of us spend time studying all kind of stuff that's not important. This is worth knowing. This is worth understanding. This is worth seeing. How did God move? How did God unfold himself? How did God make himself known? How did we reach where we are today? How did these things unfold? It's important to us, friends. So let's kind of dig a little bit into this a little bit. Not going to be too long, but we're building. And every week, we want to get some level of encouragement, some level of inspiration, some level of understanding. So to the angel of the church of Pergamos write, these things said he, which had the sharp sword with the two edges. But the banner would have gone and, you know, bring that up, but we understand this, the word chaplain, two-edged sword. So I'm not going to spend too much time there. And he says, now, I know thy works. And Brother Branham, he would have touched this briefly in the first two ages, but here he kind of expounded on this, I know thy works. I want to stop here a little bit before going on. He said, these are the identical words uttered to each of the seven messengers relative to the people of God in each age. I know thy works. In other words, I know what you're doing. That's powerful. I know what you've been doing. I know your works. He said, as they are spoken to the two vines, true and false, they will bring joy and gladness to the hearts of one group. But they ought to strike terror in the hearts of the other. So I know thy works. I see your prayer life. I see your zeal. I see your commitment. I see your committed Bible study. All these are works, eh? I see you help the poor. I see you do all you can for the kingdom. I know your works. I see you trying. I see you're pressing on. God is not ignorant of these things. He is not seeing these things. He is very much aware of it. But at the same time, he know all the works. So Brother Branham is saying here that in seeing this, he's talking about the fruit of your life. So he said, if this verse means anything at all, it means that what a man does, he is. So I want us to catch tonight that when God is saying, I know thy works, he is looking at our actions. So you say you believe, show me. You say you believe, live it. You say you're a Christian, then express it in your life. He said, the fruit or works of his life will be a product of the kind of seed in him. Anybody with me tonight? All right? So Brother Branham brought some scripture. He said, that a fountain sent forth at the same place sweet water and bitter. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? So he's making a point that out of your heart, he said, either make the tree good and his fruit good, or else the tree corrupt and his fruit corrupt, for the tree is known by his fruit. O generation of vipers, how can ye, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. A good man out of the good treasure of the heart, bringing forth good things. And an evil man out of the evil treasure, bringing forth evil things. All right, so the fruit or works of his life will be a product of the kind of seed or light that is in him. His works, therefore, will be scriptural. Oh, Brother Branham said, what an indictment this truth is going to be against the Pergamian age. There stands that matchless one, and in his hand the sharp sword with the two edges, the word of God, and that word will judge us in this last day. In fact, the word is judging even now. Right now it's judging. For it is the discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. It cuts asunder. I know thy works. Listen to the prophet now. He said, if a man fears that he might not please God, then let him fulfill the word. I love that. It makes it very simple. So if you're worried tonight, what your standing is, Don't worry no more. Just fulfill the word. Because by fulfilling the word, you can rest with confidence that God can know that your works in line with the word. If a man wonders if he will hear those words, well done, good and faithful servant, let him fulfill the word of God in his life, and assuredly he will hear those words of praise. So the challenge for us, friends, is living this word, you know. But for you to live this word, you have to know the word, you have to live. You have to know the word, you have to hear it, you have to recognize it, you have to act on it. It is not going to be easy, but this is our commission. This is our challenge. The word of truth, all right? So let's go on. I know thy works and where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is. And thou holdest fast my name and hast not denied my faith, even in those days wherein Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was slain among you where Satan dwelleth. Now that's a big verse, and I don't know how much further I can get to that verse, but I really wanted to get into Balaam. So we'll have to see how we could kind of divide this up a bit, right? So Brother Branham say, I know thy works, we touch on that, the Bible said that, and where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is. So Brother Branham was bringing out here the reason that this is part of the eulogy. This is a powerful statement, eh? Even where Satan's seat is. Brother Branham said, the reason that this is part of the eulogy of the Spirit is because these brave soldiers of the cross in this age were overcoming Satan, I love it, right in the midst of his own throne room. What a testimony, eh? Let me say that one more time. I know thy works and where thou dwellest. In other words, I see in your works, I see in your victory, I see you overcoming. And it's not just in isolation, it is in the context of where you're living. Because I know where you're dwelling, even where Satan's seat is. So you're right in the heart of evil. And Brother Branham said, they were winning, they were overcoming Satan right in the midst of his own throne room. Now, these are not just words, you know, because we're going to see it, and I don't have all time to go to it tonight, but he said they were winning the battle through the name and faith of Jesus Christ right in the camp of the leaders of darkness. What a tremendous commendation. If this age is, this is like this age, because we're in Satan's Eden, eh? And God is having a bunch of overcomers who, if Brother Branham was speaking about you now in this day, he would say, they, I like this, is that these brave soldiers, do we have any brave soldiers here tonight? These brave soldiers of the cross were overcoming Satan right in the midst of his own throne room. Satan sitting on the throne room, and that not moving you. You're not afraid. You're not bending. You're not giving in. You're not supporting. They were winning the battle through the name and faith of Jesus Christ right in the camp of the leaders of darkness. What a tremendous commendation, like the mighty men of David who invaded the camp of the enemy to bring David thirst-quenching water. So these giants of the faith. That's how we describe those believers in that day. And in this day, we also have giants of the faith. Invaded the realm of Satan's earthly stronghold, and by preaching and exhorting, brought the water of salvation to those who lived under the shadow of death. So Brother Branham here was bringing out now Pergamos. That name also means Satan, throne, and dwelling place. And I don't have time to go into all of this, but Brother Branham would have traced out from Nimrod, from the Tower of Babel, which was that original core of where Babylon started, and what Nimrod tried to achieve, the worship, the unity, the whole vision trying to connect to heaven, and how God had to disrupt the language at that point, and how what started in Babylon there under Nimrod could be traced out through every generation, even to the Babylon that Daniel would have interacted with. Anybody with me? And Brother Branham would have brought out there that Babylon, we know, is supposed to be the seat where Satan is. He said that has always been the actual literal seat. But he said here that there in Pergamos, in that day, in the form of a living serpent, remember he spoke about the living serpent that they actually worshipped? He said there in Pergamos, in the form of a living serpent, he was worshipped. So he said it was true satanic worship there in that city of Pergamos. So they were actually directly worshiping the devil in that age. The tree of the knowledge of good and evil, now symbolized in the form of a living serpent, had not only seduced Eve, but the majority of mankind. And Brother Branham was able to trace from Nimrod's day all the way into the Roman Catholic Church, all the symbologies, all the different gods, the different idols, everything. But he asked the question, but how did Pergamos become the seat of Satan if Babylon was his seat? He said the answer again is in history. When Babylon fell to the Medes and the Persians, the priest king, Attalus, fled the city. So he left Babylon and went to Pergamos with his priests and sacred mysteries. There he set up his kingdom outside the Roman Empire and thrived, Brother Branham said, under the care of the devil. So by the time Martin is on the earth with a small group of believers, they're facing off the results of the remnant of who would have survived from the Medes and the Persians hiding under the care of the devil that led to that Satan worship that they were living in that day. So that is what created that environment that God can now speak through John, saying, I know thy works and where you're living, where you dwellest, even where Satan's seat is, because I know you're in there. You're in that city where you're right there in the heart of it. And thou holdest fast my name. So in the midst of it, hallelujah, in the midst of where Satan's seat is, in the midst of the evil there, they hold fast my name and has not denied my faith. You could have a testimony, friends. I want the young people to see this on your job. There's no excuse to not have a testimony. Here it was. You have devil worship. You have people literally have a literal snake to symbolize the serpent, worshiping in that environment, all the filth, all the fornication, everything going on there. And yet still, in the midst of that, there are a group of believers who, I know thy works and where thou dwellest. Yes, we're in the hardest age, but there have been ages before, like the Pergamos age, where Satan's seat was right there. And we see the lid of hell uncovered now. And we see Satan has liberty to move how he wants to move as the god of this evil age. But if there would have been people in that day who could resist and stand and hold fast his name and has not denied his faith, I believe tonight that there are people who could do the same thing. Especially given the fact that we have the revealed word. Every mystery is revealed. We can look into the scripture and know where we stand in. We can recognize the devil at every one of his tricks. Anybody believe that tonight? I know thy works. We'll touch on these things. We'll go into some more history and bring these things out. But I want to kind of get through to at least get this into the group tonight. I know thy works and where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is. And thou holdest fast my name and has not denied my faith. You know how many believers deny faith? I said to young people, how embarrassing is it? You on your job and you don't want to pray for your lunch because everybody around you and you embarrass. You don't want to bow your head and pray. That is denying the faith, you know? In that simple way. Give us real Christians who are not ashamed to say, I'm a Christian. There are things I don't do. There are places I don't go. There are associations I cannot have because I am not going to deny my faith. I'm not going to deny his faith. I'm going to hold fast to his name. He who started the work in me is able to complete it. It is impossible to get in trouble if you are holding fast to his name and don't deny his faith. Because if you live and practice, I call it practice the presence of God. What is that? If Jesus is right next to you right now, would you say that? Would you do that? Would you act that way? If he's in your room? How would you operate if he walk in your room right now? You see what I said about Martin? There was only Christ on his lips. How would you speak if Jesus in your room next to you? What would you put on in your ears when you're listening to if Jesus is right next to you? You heard what Brother Ty said on Sunday, what Brother Kai said? Could you hand your phone to the prophet? Would the prophet be pleased what you have on your phone? Let's take it higher. Could you hand your phone to the Lord Jesus? Say, well, I want to borrow your phone. Could you hand your phone to him? I want to send a message. So you're going into your WhatsApp and you check it and you bought. But what was the last message you sent? Anybody with me tonight? So we're still in verse 13. I know thy works and where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is, and thou holdest fast my name. That's a testimony. And has not denied my faith. And then he goes on, even in those days, wherein Antipas was my faithful martyr. So God is making a distinction in their holding of defeat and holding fast to his name, even when it got really bad, to the point that Antipas was killed. And Brother Branham was saying that there is no other record in the word or any other profane history. By profane history, I mean no other historian pick up this man called Antipas. But clearly, and listen to this, but surely there's no need to be. It is more than enough that he was foreknown and known of the Lord. It is more than enough to see his faithfulness unto the Lord recorded in the living word. He was a Christian. He had the name of Jesus. He had the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, and he was among those who lived by it. This is such a blessing. And I want you to see why this is such a blessing. There are many names in the Bible we could reference to different points. So when we read Hebrews 11, and we could reference by faith this one, by faith this one, and we could go into the Old Testament and see who they were. So we could kind of connect, and we have a reason to know why it is by faith, because we could reference it. But the Abraham is saying here, there's no record of Antipas anywhere else in scripture or in any history book. But the fact that God himself will take notice of Antipas is enough, because he is mentioned as a martyr. He is mentioned as one who stood for truth. And listen to the prophet. He respected no one. He feared no one when death was pronounced. So he's describing the attribute of a martyr. When death was pronounced upon all who would take that name and walk in the faith of Jesus Christ, he took his stand, and with those who would not turn back, yes, he died. But like Abel, he obtained a witness from God. His name is written in the word. And though dead, listen to the prophet, though dead, his voice still speaks in the pages of God's divine record. Another faithful martyr was carried to his rest. Hallelujah. Glory. Who was slain among you where Satan dwelleth. So God tying it into that situation and environment, right there where Satan was dwelling. They were going after the Christians, and they were these faithful believers. This small group in that beautiful city, as it were, that beautiful environment, as it were, that could be parallel to our beautiful sophistication and all the fashions and all this stuff going on. Where is that faithful group tonight who is still standing even where Satan's seat is, holding fast to his name and has not denied his faith? I'm getting ready to close out, but I just want to drop this and see if I could get a few more minutes. So all of verse 13 is a credit, is a testimony. It's similar to the Ephesians church age, where God is saying, this is what is working for you. This is what is the positive about your age. But in verse 14, he said, but I have a few things against thee, because thou hast there them. So in other words, among you, thou hast there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed unto idols and to commit fornication. Anybody with me? I want to see if we could just touch just one quickly, and then we'll have to continue. I have to figure out what the next continuation title will be, because we have to keep going. All right. Now, but Brother Branham said, and verse 15, which is right under, so hast thou also them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which thing I hate. So Brother Ovid last week spoke about the Nicolaitans. And Brother Branham would have said, in the Ephesus age, it was the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which is the activities or the actions or the attributes or the behaviors of the Nicolaitans. But by the time it reached the Pergamian age, it was no longer deeds. It was now doctrine. So it was now taught. It was now enforced. It was now a way of life. Okay. So he said, now, in dealing with the doctrine of Balaam, Brother Branham said, no, you can't have a Nicolaitan set up in the church and not have the other doctrine come in too. You see, if you take away the word of God and the moving of the spirit as a means of worship, because they that worship me must worship me in spirit and in truth, then you will have to give the people another form of worship as a substitute. And substitution spells Balaamism. Now, if you want to understand what the doctrine of Balaam is in the New Testament church, we had better go back and see what it was in the Old Testament church and apply it to the third age and then bring it to the present. And the story is found in Numbers 22 through 25. And I want to see how quickly I can run through this because we don't have too much time in this teaching, but I want us to touch it. I'm just going to summarize. We're going to spend some time in the future and go into it in more details. Now, we know that Israel was the chosen people of God. They were the Pentecostals of their day. They had taken the refuge under the blood. They had all been baptized in the Red Sea and had come up out of the water singing in the spirit and dancing under the energy of the Holy Ghost while Miriam, the prophetess, played a tambourine. Well, after a certain time, journeying, these children of Israel came to Moab. Now, you remember who Moab was. He was the son of Lot by one of his own daughters, and Lot, in turn, was the nephew of Abraham. So Israel and Moab were related. I want you to see that. They're related. The Moabites knew the truth, whether they lived up to it or not. So Israel come up to the borders of Moab. Remember, they're coming out there. They're making progress. They come to the borders of Moab and send messages to the king saying, "We are brothers. Let us pass through your land. If our people or our animals eat or drink anything, we have no problem paying for it." But King Balak, who was king of the Moabites, got very excited. This is the prophet dramatizing it now. He got excited. That head of that Nicolaitan bunch, talking about the Moabites, was not about to let the church come through with its signs and wonders and diverse manifestation of the Holy Ghost, with their faces shining with the glory of God. It was too risky. He might lose some of his crowd. So Balak refused to let Israel pass through. So Brother Branham is dramatizing. The children of Israel victorious. They're on fire. The children of Israel just come out of slavery. Moab, who would have been the center of Lot, they didn't know about slavery. They didn't know about that. They know about God. They would have hear testimony. This is Lot's children. Eh? So this is Lot who God bring out. So they have their own testimony. The Lord brought Lot out. We came out. And they could have their own story. Our cousins was in Egypt. Now they're free. And now Israel and Moab meet up again. And Balak, seeing the Israelites come and see them fellas looking too happy. And Brother Branham dramatized it. He didn't want to risk these rejoicing, excited, jubilant Israelites passing through Moab and he losing members because them fellas on fire. Brother Branham said, in fact, so great was his fear of them that he went to a hireling prophet called Balaam. Now, a hireling prophet is like a prophet for hire. A prophet who on the payroll, a prophet who could be politically swayed, politically motivated, a prophet who understand how to play the cards right, a prophet who is a somebody who understand how God operates and but he has another agenda. So Balak going to a hireling prophet named Balaam and ask him to mediate between him and God, because Balak know that he can't go to God. He know he needs to get to a prophet. So he gets a hireling prophet and ask him to mediate between him and God, to petition Almighty God, listen to the request, to ask God to curse Israel and to render them impotent. In other words, he just want Israel to lose their joy, lose their fire, curse them, finish them, shock, put all that kind of stuff there. Anybody with me? I'm trying to do this as quickly as possible. And listen to the prophet. And Balaam, being eager to take part in political affairs and become a great man, you see why spiritual ambition could be a problem, was only too glad to do so. But seeing that he had to approach and receive an order from God to get the people cursed, as he couldn't do it by himself, he went to ask God, listen to this, you know. So I want us to understand the paradox of the situation. Here you have a king of Moab, get a fake prophet to go and ask God, hey, I want you to go and ask God to curse Israel. And Balaam actually gone to ask God, Lord, you could curse them? He went to ask God if he could have this permission to go. Now, isn't that just like the Nicolaitans we have with us today? They curse everyone that won't go their way. When Balaam asked God for permission to go, God turned him down. Of course God will turn him down. Israel is his people. My dad stung, but Balak insisted, promising him even greater rewards and honor. So imagine you went to God and God turned you down and you let somebody promise you more rewards and you will go back again. So Balaam went back to God. Now, one answer from God, Brother Branham said, should have been enough, but not so for self-will Balaam. Now, this is where a lot of people get tied up. Eh? When God saw his perversity, he told him to get up and go. Quickly, he saddled the donkey and away he went. He should have realized that this was simply God's permissive will. So Balaam riding away now, after the second time I see him, the Lord tell me to go and curse Israel now. The Lord spoke to me. The Lord told me. And if you don't realize that what God tell you is not what he intend to happen, and you in permissive will, you there can tie up a set of people and say, well, the Lord spoke to me. The Lord showed me something. The Lord spoke to me. The Lord showed me something. And it's not what he's supposed to be doing. Yeah? He should have realized that this was simply God's permissive will, and he wouldn't be able to curse them if he went 20 times and tried 20 times. That's the prophet. How like Balaam are people today? They believe in three gods, get baptized in three titles under the name, and yet God will send the Spirit upon them as he did upon Balaam, and they will go on believing that they are exactly right. And here they are actually perfect Balaamites. See the doctrine of Balaam. Go ahead anyway, do it your own way. They say, well, God has blessed us. It must be all right. I know he has blessed you. I don't deny that, but it's the same organizational route that Balaam took. It's the defiance of God's word, it falls teaching. So Balaam went wildly down the road until an angel from God stood in his way. But that prophet, I'm going to about him say bishop, cardinal, chairman, president, and general overseer, was so blinded to spiritual things by the thought of honor and glory and money that he could not see the angel standing with drawn sword. There he stood to block the mad prophet. So the angel had to block this crazy prophet. The little donkey saw him and dodged back and forth until he finally crushed Balaam's foot against a stone wall. The ass stopped and would not go on. He could not. So Balaam jumped off and began to beat him. The donkey then began to talk to Balaam. This is history. Eh? God let that donkey speak in a tongue. That donkey was no hybrid. He was original seed. He said to the blinded prophet, am I not your donkey? And haven't I carried you faithfully? Balaam replied, yes, yes, you are my donkey and you have carried me faithfully and until now. And if I can't get you going, I'm going to kill you. Whoa, what's this talking to a donkey? That's funny, I thought. I heard that donkey talking and I was answering it back. God has always spoken in tongue, Brother Branham said. He spoke at Belshazzar's feast and then at Pentecost. He's doing it again today. It's a warning of soon coming judgment. I'm almost done. Then the angel was made visible to Balaam. You see how backslidden Balaam was? His donkey saw the angel before he did. He told Balaam that except for the donkey, he would be dead even now for tempting God. So the donkey actually saved Balaam. But when Balaam promised to go back, he was sent on with the admonition to say only what God gave him. So Balaam went down and set up 7 altars for the clean beasts of sacrifice. He killed a ram, signifying the coming of the Messiah. He knew what to do to approach unto God. This is powerful now, eh? He had the mechanics just right. So he's having a church service, eh? And Brother Branham is saying, he had the mechanics just right. He know how to lay everything out. He could put quote upon quote. He could put mystery upon mystery. He have the 7 altars. He have the clean sacrifice. He know the ram and he put it on the ram and all these things. He had the mechanics just right, but not the dynamics, same as now. Can't you see it, Nicolaitans? There was Israel down there in the valley offering the same sacrifice. So Balaam offering sacrifice there, and he offering sacrifice here, right? But only one had signs following. Only one had God in their midst. Form wouldn't get you anywhere. It can't take the place of spirit manifestation. And this is what people are running from in the message. Spirit manifestation, form. They have form and not spirit manifestation. That is what happened at Nicaea. They put over Balaam's doctrine, not the doctrine of God. And they stumbled. Yeah, they fell. They became dead men. Listen now. Getting ready to close out. After the sacrifice was made, Balaam was ready to prophesy. But God tied his tongue up and he could not curse Israel. How could he curse them? How could anybody curse you? Yeah? The royal seed of Abraham? Hallelujah. How could anybody, nobody, people want to say you can't make it. When they say you can't make it, God turn it into you're going to make it. Hallelujah. After the sacrifice was made, Balaam was ready to prophesy, but God tied his tongue up and he could not curse them. He blessed them. Balak was very angry. Remember, Balak done cashing checks and cashing out investments to pay the prophet. So as far as he's concerned, Balaam's supposed to be delivering a result. Balak was very angry, but there was nothing that Balaam could do about the prophecy. It had been spoken by the Holy Ghost. So Balak told Balaam to go down below into the valley and look upon their back paths to see if there wasn't possibly some way he could curse them. So this is now where it get down into what was happening in Pergamos now. So it's not just the doctrine of Balaam. It's not just the own will. But this is where the divisiveness starts. So Balak told Balaam to go down into the valley and look upon their back path to see if there wasn't possibly some way he could curse them. He said the tactics that Balak used are the same tactics they use today. The big denominations look down at the little groups and anything they find amongst them to make other scandal, they bring it out and shout it. If the moderns live in sin, no one says anything about it. But let one of the elect get into trouble and every paper blasted across the country. Yes, Israel had her back canal parts. They had their side that wasn't praiseworthy. But listen to this, in spite of their imperfections, by the purpose of God that works through election by grace and not by works, they had the cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night. They had the smitten rock, the brazen serpent, and the signs and wonders. They were vindicated, not in themselves, but in God. That is powerful. And that is our testimony. You believe that? God didn't have respect for any of those Nicolaitans with their PhDs, LEDs, and all that stuff. I'm trying to close this out here. Now, in spite of the fact that Balaam knew the proper approach to God and could bring forth a revelation from the Lord by means of a spiritual endowment of power, he was still, for all of that, a bishop in the false group. For what did he do now in order to win the favor of Balak? He formulated a plan wherein God would be forced to deal with Israel in death, just as Satan knew that he could beguile Eve, thus causing God to pass his pronounced sentence of death against him. So Balaam knew if he could get Israel to sin, God would have to deal with them in death. Listen to now. I want you to catch this now. So he planned a way to get them to come over and join in sin. He sent out invitations to come to the feast of Baal Peor. Come over and worship with us. Now, Israel, no doubt, had seen the feast of the Egyptians, so they did not feel it was too wrong to just look on and perhaps eat with the people. And this is why, young people, I say, when you have stuff on your job or any situation, you have to know to shun the very appearance of evil. So, but Abraham said, these children of Israel felt they could have handled the environment that Moab created for them. They didn't feel it was too wrong to go and just look on and perhaps eat with the people. What is wrong with fellowship anyway? We are supposed to love them, aren't we? Or how can we win them? You see, Brother Brandon put the context there? Being friendly never hurt anyone, or so they thought. But when those sexy Moabitish women began to dance and undress while they whirled around doing their rock and roll and twist, the lust rose up in the Israelites and they were drawn into adultery, and God in wrath slew 40,000 of them. That is what Constantine and his successors did at Nicaea and after Nicaea. They invited the people of God to the convention, and when the church sat down to eat and rose up to play, partaking of, he typed it now, church form, ceremonies, pagan feasts, named after Christian rites, she was trapped. She had committed fornication. So Balaam got Israel to commit fornication. And this is what brings that whole thing together there. But I have a few things against thee, because thou hast there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam, the ways of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed unto idols, and to commit fornications. So I will stop there tonight. So I want to encourage you, church, as we go through this, to see that Brother Branham was typing this here, it is in the Old Testament, it is in the Pergamos age, and it's also reflected here in this age now. So we need to be spiritually mature and keep looking now at God unfolding his will, his purpose, his plan, and how in the midst of it, there would be believers who would stand and there'd be believers who didn't stand or believers who were of the false vine, or believers who allow themselves to get deceived, believers who allow themselves to get enticed, and through it all, God's purpose will be accomplished. Let us bow our heads for a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you tonight, Lord, for your love, for your grace to us. Lord, for this time of just going through your word. Lord, your word is so rich. It's so powerful. There's so much in this. We could talk all night long. We could spend every day talking about it, and we would not be able to even finish it because it's inexhaustible. There's no end. There's no beginning. Lord, you are the word. Lord, you are the Alpha. You are the Omega. Lord, you are our everything. So, Lord, I pray tonight, Lord, that you would speak to your people and you would help us to understand how all these pieces, Lord, come together, how you are working your way out, how in every age you prepared people who could deal with the challenge of that specific age. Lord, and to think as rough as that age was back there, that this is the darkest age. This is the hardest age. And how you prepared a special group of people under the ministry of the seventh angel, the seventh star, the seventh messenger. Lord, that we could be equipped. Lord God, like no other people have been equipped, because we have the opportunity to look through all the ages and to see how every age had a witness, every age had a people, every age had a testimony, every age had those that overcame. And even in this age, there's a promise of overcoming, and there's a reward to the overcomers. Help us to overcome. Help us to have a testimony, Lord, of how we labored. Help us have a testimony of how we were patient. Help us to have a testimony of not having fear. Help us to have a testimony that even though we know where Satan's seat is, even though there's a God of this evil age, that we could hold fast to your name, that we could not deny your faith, and we could keep your faith in our hearts, and we could have a testimony in our homes, in our families, in our jobs, in whatever we do, Lord. Help us, Lord, and strengthen us. May you bless the service tomorrow night, Lord, and may you bless the prayer meeting on Friday night and the service coming Sunday, Lord. May you be with your people. We commit your people into your hands in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen and amen. May the Lord richly bless you tonight. Stay on fire. Stay in the word. Stay in the presence. And you do your own study. You pull your own inspiration, and God will do the rest. May the Lord richly bless you tonight. Have a wonderful night. God bless you.